Howdy and welcome to Burley United Methodist Church's worship service for Sunday, April 16th. We are grateful that you could join us, whether you are in the Magic Valley area or maybe even places around the world. We are grateful. Our opening hymn this morning is "To God Be the Glory." The call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 22 and the work of John in the New Testament, the book of Revelation, as well as his gospel. I will read the light print. I'll ask you to respond in the bold. Grace to you and peace from the one who is and who was and who is to come. We gather in the name of Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead. God calls us to proclaim our faith, to put our trust in reality as yet unseen. In Christ, we know the peace of God and the freedom from the fears that bind us. Receive the Holy Spirit and recognize your call. God meets and empowers you now. We know God has expectations of us. We want to hear and respond. Please join me in the prayer of the day. Penetrate our closed minds, loving God, with the assurance of your supportive presence and the challenge of discipleship. Quiet the fears that keep us from living the truth and witnesses to it. Come to deliver us as individuals and nations from the temptations of coercive power. Be to us the beginning and the ending of all things and our motivation and direction in all the in-between times. Amen. Our next hymn is "Just As I Am." As we come to this time of prayer, we lift up the needs of ourselves as well as those whom we know and love. We also pray to give God thanks. We also pray to adore God, because God demands our adoration. Let us come and pray. O God of all wisdom, the truth of your love is like a rare treasure. Its value exceeds comprehension, and its scope is beyond the furthest limits of our imagination. To grasp it for a moment is to be lifted high above whatever may threaten us. To be nurtured by it is to be held in an embrace that protects us from ultimate harm. Your truth leads us along the way of life that develops discipleship, challenges our wisdom, which is self-centered, and helping us to focus on your commands and desires. It breeds acts of compassion, causing steps to be taken that will bring justice to light. It holds within its hope for tomorrow and puts in perspective the toil of the day. We give you thanks for Christ Jesus, who makes your love known. It is through him that we claim our inheritance and participate in the promise of a day without end. As he taught his disciples what it means to serve others, so also we learn how we ought to live. As he sacrificed himself on the cross for our salvation, so also we know that we may suffer abuse, as the grave could not hold him, since he dwells by your side, so also our foes will not harm us, since we abide by your grace. O God, as we reaffirm our confession in Christ, our Redeemer, help us to pass on to others the truth of your love. May we be for them a treasure trove of understanding and acceptance, so that they may discover the wealth of your blessings. We pray for guidance as we act out Christ's gospel, for each individual has a particular need to be met. Help us to treat your people as unique sisters and brothers. Help us to make the most of unexpected opportunities to share your benevolent mercy and care, so that others are led to confess you as their God. We pray all these things in the name of your Son, Jesus, who taught his disciples when they prayed to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we profess those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. So much of my life, and I suspect yours as well, has always been a balancing act, weighing priorities, ordering priorities that vie for our attention as well as our energy. Working and parenting seem to capture the majority of our time from our 20s through our 50s and even beyond. As an Army chaplain, deployments, war, moving, kids, school, and marriage were all the balls I juggled for 25 years. One definition of a successful Army career is leaving the Army with the same family you started with. I am humbled to say that I had a successful Army career. In today's scripture passages, we are going to look at two parts of forgiveness that must be kept in balance, for both parts are necessary. And even though Jesus gives us these commands, initially they might look contradictory. From Mark 11, starting with verse 25. Whenever you stand praying, forgive. If you have anything against anyone, so that your Father in heaven may also forgive you your trespasses. It is very customary to stand when you pray. In the Greek Orthodox Church, it is customary throughout the entire worship service to stand. By standing, we honor God. Just as we stand for our nation's anthem is played, or when we pledge allegiance to our flag. I was hoping that I would be vindicated in my stance when I started writing these sermons, that I was not obligated to forgive anyone who had wronged me until they had asked for forgiveness. But this one verse in Mark informs me that I am wrong again. What it also tells me is that God's forgiveness is not dependent upon our forgiving others, but to be unforgiving reveals that we have truly failed to understand and accept God's unmerited grace ourselves. If forgiving is too hard, as is humbling yourself before God, and it seems that the joy that comes from accepting and knowing Christ is also absent. This is step one, and you can't go to step two until you've taken that first step. Without the humility that sees yourself as deserving condemnation, and without the joy of Christ's love in your life, it will be easy to seek or desire revenge upon the person who wronged you. Matthew writes in his gospel, Jesus said to Simon Peter, not seven times, but I tell you 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. And when he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. We looked at this passage several weeks ago. If you haven't forgiven someone, Jesus is telling you that now is the time. If this was the only passage that we had of Jesus modeling forgiveness, we would have put all the emphasis on the person who was wronged. But we also have this passage from Luke. Be on your guard, for if another disciple sins, you must rebuke the offender. And if there is repentance, you must forgive. And if the same person sins against you seven times a day and turns back to you seven times a day, I say, I repent. You must forgive. These are two tasks set forth in these two verses. First, if someone sins against you, let them know. Don't allow yourself to suffer in silence. And if they repent, then your second task is to forgive them. Confront and forgive are our responsibilities. I don't know about you, but I perform both of these tasks poorly. The Holy Spirit reminds me of my duties. How well I perform them is up to me and my conscience. It's much easier to turn a blind eye to another believer's sin than it is to require the church to do the costly work of reconciliation. The purpose of forgiveness is not for the offender to be paid back for their offense, but rather the restoration of a relationship. God forgives us not to make us feel defeated or humiliated, but to correct and restore a right relationship with God. When we forgive others, we do the exact same thing. And when we are forgiven, it is supposed to be done for the same reason. So while the Luke 17 passage hints that forgiveness is not necessary until to be granted, until there is repentance, Luke recounts in Acts that while he was being murdered, the deacon Stephen prays, "Lord, do not hold these sins against them." And then after he said that, he died. It is very clear there is no inkling of repentance here in this gang who has attacked, this mob that has attacked Stephen. He forgave them, just as God forgave those who crucified his son on the cross. So both directives Jesus gives about forgiveness are true. And the only way this can happen is if the word forgiveness is used in more than one way. The Mark 11 passage that we looked at first puts the initiative on the one hurt to forgive in one's heart. This is the inward forgiveness that we are, as the one hurt, means that we choose not to avenge the wrong. This inward forgiveness is not for the one who is in the wrong. It is for us. We forgive so that we can get on with our lives, finding personal joy and happiness. We do this to purge ourselves from the bitterness that we have when we are hurt. Bitterness is like a poison. One drop can contaminate a whole water well. This removal of bitterness is the outward element of forgiving, which can be challenging. It is in this stage that we are outwardly or publicly shown the one who has hurt us, especially if they are a friend or a family member, that they are forgiven and the relationship or the friendship has been restored. These stages, first inward and then secondary outward, are not two different kinds of forgiveness, but rather two different stages of forgiveness. To be a minimalist when it comes to forgiveness, the inward part first needs to happen for the forgiveness to be genuine. And then the outward comes along later. True Christian forgiveness is not simplistic, nor is it individualistic. There is always more than just the healing of one's heart. God's concern is always for the healing of his creation, even the social healing of a community. And second, Christian forgiveness never dismisses or undermines the pursuit of justice. Rather, Christian forgiveness promotes it. Forgiveness promotes justice. Forgiveness never seeks vengeance. In a recent episode of NCIS, Agent Parker, when he was an FBI agent, had accidentally shot his partner in a shootout with drug dealers. Parker's ex-FBI partner had forgiven him, but Parker had not forgiven himself. And to cope, Parker found it much easier to seek vengeance upon the drug dealer who caused the shootout than to accept the forgiveness from his partner. Sometimes the hardest person to forgive is yourself. Inward forgiveness changes from desire for pain to be inflicted upon the wrongdoer to seeking that they find the path of redemption and salvation. We seek justice within the framework of forgiveness because injustice brings more pain and more chaos in God's creation. Justice speaks truth in love, as well as making everyone face the consequences of their actions. Doing justice is an act of love and wanting others to be free from the evil that is in their hearts. Stephen McDonald used to be a New York City police officer. One day on duty, he was shot 3 times by a 15-year-old. Those bullets left him a quadriplegic. 6 months after the birth of his son, Stephen McDonald felt that God had placed a message on his heart about changing his life. His first prayer was to ask God to help him forgive his attacker. After that, he began to write him in jail. And after writing countless letters, all of them unanswered, Stephen McDonald did receive a letter from his attacker apologizing for his actions. And while he continued to write, the attacker wrote only a few more times until he was let out of prison. And 3 weeks later, the attacker died in a motorcycle crash. While there was no reconciliation between Stephen and his attacker, he felt that his actions were not a waste of time, for it allowed him to let him go of his bitterness. For the most part, we are a product of the company we keep. And for the last 60 years, the company I have kept have been people just like you. Having officiated at a dozen high schools and a half dozen junior high schools in the area, I can attest to the fact that there are a lot of non-church folk in southern Idaho, most of them parents and coaches. So when I read our Lord's Sermon on the Mount, I can point to whom Jesus is not talking about. After the opening verses of his sermon that had come to be known as the Beatitudes, Jesus talks about a righteousness that exceeds even those of the Pharisees. The Pharisees were lay folk, regular churchgoers, well, worship goers, not church, who were super religious, who sought and followed the law 24/7. So for Jesus to talk about somebody who was even more righteous than these men, that was hard to fathom. And Jesus said, "You have heard it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist an evildoer. But if anyone strikes you on the right cheek, turn the other also. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your coat, give him your cloak as well. And if anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go a second. Give to everyone who begs from you, and do not refuse anyone who wants to borrow from you." I don't know about you, but I've had a hard time fulfilling, doing all these things that Jesus tells me to do in this passage. Twice in my army career, I have been on the front lines resisting two evildoers, Saddam Hussein and Kim Jong-il, the dictator of North Korea. So what is Jesus really saying here? Please remember that the New Testament was not written in English. That was the original language, was Greek. And so sometimes we lose things in translation. How I translate, do not resist an evildoer, is do not retaliate. Our Lord gives us four illustrations here. The first is to strike you on your, if someone strikes you on the right cheek. If I was right-handed and I was going to slap somebody on the right cheek, I would use the back part of my hand to do that. To strike someone on the right cheek is not so much to inflict physical harm upon them, but rather it is a way to humiliate them. The first part of this passage means that we are not to humiliate others. Second, when we are sued, we are to offer that person collateral. In this case, our shirt or even your coat, rather than counter-suing. Next, in ancient wars, the army would conscript or impress civilians into servitude to carry loads of equipment or provisions that the soldiers needed. Jesus saying to help those soldiers who were there to keep the peace, you are to help them not just walk 1 mile, but to do it a second. Jesus is not only teaching us that we should not allow evil to have its way, but by resisting evil, we are not to target evil, not to target the evil ones physically and give them physical harm, nor are we to ruin their reputations on paying back. One writer wrote about this passage as, this is a very spiritual teaching. I must be right in my attitude toward myself and the spirit of self-defense that immediately rises when any wrong is done to me. I must also deal with the desire for revenge and the spirit of retaliation, so that it is so characteristic of the natural self. But like the late night TV commercial, you hear these four dreaded words, but wait, there's more. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemy and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be children of your Father in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the righteous and on the unrighteous. For if you love those who love you, what reward to you do you have? Do you not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers and sisters, what more are you than theirs? Do you not even the Gentiles do the same? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. Jesus starts out with, you've heard it said, you shall love your fellow Jew, but you shall hate everyone else. Which seems, if you look at what's going on in Israel, the West Bank, in the Gaza Strip, the people of Israel are strictly following Leviticus 19, verses 17 and 18, for the last 2,000 years. But Jesus is preaching that everyone is to be treated as if they are family, whether or not they are Jewish or not. As followers of Christ, we are called, instructed, commanded to embrace his words. Even these words, which I think we would all agree means that we are to show love rather than hate. We are not to show distinction in how we treat or greet others. We are to show them peace and shalom. We are to be indiscriminate in the way we show Christian love. We are not to count the cost in loving others. A philanthropist is not interested in making profit. A philanthropist is interested in making a difference. A philanthropist truly believes that it's better to give than it is to receive. And this passage ends with four rhetorical questions. What we are to take from these are, one, we should live our lives showing love that is basically distinct from the rest of society, and two, we can live our lives showing the love in this way because Christ first loved us. We are to live our lives not based on might makes right, or with pride, or even of honor, but rather we are to live our lives respecting others, bestowing, showing grace upon others, living a life of humility and forgiveness and love. In late July of 2003, in which our unit went to capture Saddam Hussein's two sons, while we did not capture them, we did capture a handful of soldiers. And once those soldiers were in their cells, I visited them. I offered them a Quran, a bottle of water, and some food according to their dietary restrictions. He chose one bottle, I took the other. I drank first and ate some of the food, and then I went off and visited the other soldier. Did I love them? No. But I showed Christ's love to them, because I knew, and I still know, that Christ's love, that Christ loves them just as he loves you and as he loves me. Let us pray. Lord, this forgiveness business is hard. It is all-consuming. It is tiring. And it is rewarding. Forgive us, O Lord, the times that we don't forgive. Impress upon us that we are to love, that we are not to forgive grudgingly, but with an open heart. Guide us, O Lord, this day. We pray in your name. And all of God's people said, Amen. Thank you. And the final hymn this morning is Freely, Freely. And as we leave, keep the Sabbath day holy, that all creation may be healed and restored in the abundant life of God. Remember the treasures that are within clay jars, our mortal bodies, with an extraordinary power beyond our own, the life of Jesus Christ that has made everything visible. And the grace of Jesus Christ surround you, the Holy Spirit sustain you, and the peace of God rest upon you, now and always. And all of God's people said, Amen.